Mein ganzes Leben muss ich kämpfen. Sie wollten mich klein machen. Zum Schweigen bringen. Und sich mit aller Kraft gegen mich stellen. Doch egal, wie dunkel es um meine Zukunft gestanden ist, ich habe immer das Licht gesehen, denn ich war nie alleine.
Ich bin die Gerechtigkeit und ich bin gekommen, um zu bleiben.
Mein ganzes Leben muss ich kämpfen. Sie wollten mich klein machen. Zum Schweigen bringen. Und sich mit aller Kraft gegen mich stellen. Doch egal, wie dunkel es um meine Zukunft bringt. Mein ganzes Leben muss ich kämpfen. Sie wollten mich klein machen. Zum Schweigen bringen. Sich mit aller Kraft gegen mich stellen. Doch egal, wie dunkel es um meine Zukunft gestanden ist, ich habe immer das Licht gesehen, denn ich war nie alleine.
Ich bin die Gerechtigkeit und ich bin gekommen, um zu bleiben.
Ladies and gentlemen, now you can hear me. Herzlich willkommen zu unserem Livestream. Es ist der Plan B einer Veranstaltung, die wir eigentlich ein wenig anders hätten machen wollen. Welcome to our Plan B, the livestream. Thank you very much for being here. Corona adequate. We have only a bunch of people in this room and they're all sitting far away from each other. Most of us are young economists and economic students who have participated in a small workshop this morning. Ladies and gentlemen, die Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung calls him the Karl Marx of the 21st century, while Paul Krugman isn't sure what the message is, as he states in the New York Times. The Spiegel names him the left mastermind. Paul Mason thinks he's not radical enough. Paul Collier writes how he lost touch with reality, and the Süddeutsche refers to him as radical social democrat. My favorite, The Guardian explains what his name rhymes with. Spaghetti. Ladies and gentlemen, the French author and economist Thomas Piketty is presenting his second oeuvre, and as you know, it's physically even bigger than the first one. And he's getting very much attention for it, especially from, I think statistically very interesting, three gentlemen who are very well known in the economic scene and happen to have the same first name. Paul, Krugman, Collier, and what do we have? Mason. So 7 years ago, Thomas Piketty presented Capital of the 21st Century and sold it 2.5 million times. Its central thesis in a nutshell, private wealth is destined to outstrip economic growth. So without progressive taxation and the social welfare state, and the rich will get richer. Now in this book, Thomas Piketty suggests measures that, at least some of them, the level of inequality would go down, and at least some of them are quite unlikely to be introduced anytime soon. For example, 60% of the average wealth that would be around, I think we said 120,000 euros, 150,000 euros possibly in Austria, that would be a universal inheritance for everybody. So thinking outside of the box, Thomas Piketty, I think it's safe to say, doesn't hesitate to do that. In his book, he describes how each society has its reasons for inequality, its ideologies, and he suggests reality can be changed. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Markus Marterbauer, head of the Department of Economics and Statistics at the Austrian Federal Chamber of Labor, and Matthias Schnetzer from the Economics Department as well. They will now give us a brief introduction. Please give them a warm welcome.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the Chamber of Labor, I would like to welcome you to today's presentation of Thomas Piketty's new book. We welcome a small group of colleagues here at the Chamber of Labor, hundreds and hopefully thousands of people who have originally registered for this event and now are following us via live stream. And an especially warm welcome goes to Thomas Piketty. Thomas, it seems that you have written your new book as a birthday present to the Chamber of Labor, 100 years of Chamber of Labor, 100 years of justice. As we have seen in our short film, justice has been fighting over the last 100 years, and she has lots of reasons to fight also in the present and in the future. One reason is that the distribution of wealth is extremely unequal, and social opportunities are again depending on family background rather than expressing equality of opportunities. Thomas Piketty presented his prominent bestseller, Capital in the 21st Century, in this hall 6 years ago. I think it's not exaggerated to say that this book has changed economics, and capital and ideology will change social sciences again. Capital in the 21st Century has changed economics as it presented an enormous and unprecedented amount of completely new data and brought economics back together with economic history and the other social sciences. The new book not only extends the time period of analysis to several hundred years, but also covers countries around the globe. Piketty makes economics great again as a science analyzing the economic and social history of mankind.
And this interdisciplinary way of thinking and practicing economics has attracted, I'd say, a whole generation of young economists. These young researchers follow the tradition of the leading experts in the field, amongst whom the deceased economist Tony Atkinson was the outstanding pioneer who brought the question of distribution back in from the cold. Thanks to these colleagues, and particularly after the Great Recession, the leading economics journals were again open for articles on inequality. There were huge conferences, special issues, and inequality researchers gained again the recognition of their mainstream peers. Thomas Piketty's contributions, his papers and his books, helped a lot to reopen the scientific community for questions of inequality. A milestone in inequality research was the creation of the World Income Inequality Database, which is not only the fundament of Thomas' books, but also one of the greatest resources for empirical studies. This way, a group of excellent economists around Thomas Piketty opened new avenues for researching and teaching inequality.
For Thomas and his colleagues, analyzing data is neither la pour la, nor only ground for academic research. They share a deep faith in the emancipatory power of public data. Or as Thomas puts it in his new book, it is not my intention to substitute class war with the war of deciles. It is pleasing and encouraging that an academic economist of the highest rank is ready to engage in the political debate. With a voluminous book, a fascinating narrative, an empirically founded message, and a firm normative position. The members of the Piketty School of Economics are engaging in political movements by providing data, detailed policy proposals, and ideological support for progressive candidates all over the world. They are not only changing economics, they are changing politics as well.
And this political change is what is also urgently needed in Austria. We face tremendous inequalities in the wealth distribution, which are not only harming social cohesion, but also democracy. With wealth comes political power, or at least the means to be heard louder and to be heard more than others. The fact that a handful of very rich families own a significant share of wealth and these imbalances are passed over generations entails questions about social sustainability, the limits of democracy, and last but not least, the justification of such abundance and opulence. In other words, what is the ideology that justifies these levels of inequality in Austria? So Thomas, as you see, your research is of utmost relevance for us, also for the Chamber of Labor's fight for more fairness and for the well-being of the many, not the few. Capital in the 21st century has changed economics and politics, and we are looking forward that capital and ideology will change the world anew. So again, thanks for coming here to us today, and I'm excited for your presentation. Thanks a lot.
So ladies and gentlemen, please clap your hands for Thomas Piketty.
Thank you. I don't know if I need to use that. No, I don't. So thanks a lot for your invitation. You know, it's a great honor for me to be there. And you know, of course, it's a very important symbol to be there for this. I assume this should work at some point. The presentation should show on the screen. Yes, that's perfect. It's a very meaningful symbol for me to be there for this 100th anniversary of the Chamber of Labor, which of course is the sort of living symbol of the progress we've made throughout the 20th century toward justice and toward a better balance between the rights of owners, the rights of workers, and there's been a process towards the reduction of inequality in the 20th century, following major crises, following major shocks, you know, in particular in Europe, of course. But in the end, we've made a lot of progress in the way we organize society, with at the same time less inequality, more prosperity. And, you know, I think we can and we should continue in this direction. And I think many of the policy measures that have been adopted in the 20th century, you know, would have seemed completely radical, you know, from the point of view of 1900 or 1914, and nobody would have believed it, you know, equal and free education for all, you know, workers' rights in corporations. This is something that would have seemed completely unthinkable to many one century ago. So I think this will continue like that. And this is a general lesson from this book, that you always have some people, in particular dominant groups in societies, who tend to naturalize inequality, who tend to present inequality as natural and as impossible to change. And in fact, what you see in history is exactly the opposite, that you have permanent change, in particular through political mobilization and ideological change. So in this presentation, I'm going to show you some of the figures and tables that are presented in my book, Capital Ideology, because this is primarily a book of empirical social science research. There's 169 figures and tables in the book, so it's full of data. I'm not going to be able to present everything. The novelty as compared to Capital in the 21st century is that first I try to go beyond the scope of Western countries in a way that I was not really able to do in my previous book, partly for lack of data, partly also because my own thinking about inequality was sort of too much centered on Western Europe, North America. I mean, this book still gives more space to Western Europe and North America than their share in the world, but it also talks a lot more about the rest of the world, about inequality structures in India, in Brazil, in South Africa, in China, other parts of the world. The next main novelty is to put the center of the attention to ideas and ideology as the true driving force behind historical change in inequality regime. So wars, financial crisis, social conflict also play a role, obviously, in particular in order to accelerate some of this political and ideological change. But in the end, the struggle for ideas, the struggle over ideologies, I think is by and large even more important. And in particular, I want to stress that, you know, the class position in itself does not fully determine your ideas or ideology, does not provide you with a theory of how to organize property relations, how to organize the education system, how to organize the tax system. And there's always a large autonomy of ideas and ideology, and in order to account for the large diversity of trajectories that I observe over time and that we will observe in the future, it's important to take to analyze these dynamics of ideology in itself. So I'm first going to describe very quickly the general organization of the book, and then I will focus on a number of more specific points. So the book includes four parts, 70 chapters. So I'm sorry that it's such a long book, but I should say it's very readable. You know, it can be read absolutely by anyone. It does not require any technical knowledge of anything. It's really a book of history that can be read by anyone who is ready to spend time. So maybe with the virus, everybody is going to have a lot of time at home. So this is a good time to read. You know, when you think about what you do every day, you know, I think there are lots of things that we do that are not so useful, and spending more time reading books is not necessarily the the most stupid choice that we have in how to spend our time. But anyway, this is self-promotion. Let me try to describe the general organization of the book. So it's more or less chronological. So part one of the book is about the transformation from three functional societies, that is societies organized with a nobility, a clergy, and a third estate, which you see in most European countries, but also in most societies around the world in pre-modern societies. And so part one is about how European three functional societies transform into ownership societies in the 19th century, so particularly in France following the French Revolution, but I also look at other European countries, in particular Britain and Sweden, where it happens in different manners through different crises and different processes. What's interesting, and we'll go back to that in a minute when we talk about the French Revolution, is that you know, there's an ideal of equality that comes with ownership societies in the sense that everybody is supposed to have equal rights. And at the same time, we end up in the 19th century pretty much with sort of replacing a religion by another and with a quasi-sacralization of property and which in the end becomes in the 19th century the sort of guiding principle of political organization. One case that is particularly interesting, which I didn't know so much before doing the research for the book, is the case of Sweden, which we view today as a sort of the embodiment of a social democratic and relatively egalitarian country, but which until 1911 had a level of sacralization of private property, which in a way was even more extreme than in other European societies. So in Sweden, between 1865 and 1911, you actually distribute voting rights in proportion to your wealth and property, in the sense that, so it's not only that the top 20% only have the right to vote, but what's more interesting, what's more sophisticated, is that within the top 20%, you have between 1 and 100 voting rights, you know, depending on the amount of tax you pay and the level of your property. And in municipal elections, there's actually no upper limit. And so there's several dozen Swedish municipalities until 1911 where one individual has more than 50% of the voting rights alone. And private corporations also can vote in municipal elections in Sweden until 1911. So, you know, it's a pretty extreme way of tying property to political power. And if someone in 1910, you know, had told people in Sweden, okay, you're going to become social democratic Sweden and one of the most equal countries in the world, you know, nobody would have believed it. So I think it's an interesting story because sometimes, you know, we tend to view inequality as sort of having cultural roots. You know, some countries have culture of equality, some countries have culture of inequality, and there's nothing that will change that. But, you know, this just doesn't work. When you look at history, you see that social, political mobilization, you know, is can make a difference and can make a very large change very fast. You see that in Sweden, but you see that in other countries as well. So part two of the book looks at slave and colonial societies, and in particular the way European colonial powers completely transform the evolution of societies outside Europe and their own transformation from pre-modern, tri-functional societies to ownership societies and to further development. So I talk in particular about the case of India, which is particularly interesting because if you want to understand the very particular structure of inequality of India today, you really need to go back not only to the origins of the caste system, but maybe even more importantly to the way that British colonialism has sort of rigidified the boundaries between social categories and caste in India, which was not the case before. So it's not that India was a country with very harmonious relation between social class before the British. You know, it was very unequal, like European societies of orders were, but it was not necessarily so different. And the fact that the British colonial power organize these big colonial censuses, put all these different groups into boxes for almost a century, and distributed rights and duties according to the specific social categories, sort of gave an administrative existence to social categories and boundaries, which otherwise, you know, would not have taken this same form. Well, you know, it's very difficult to say how India would have changed without colonization, but what's clear is that if you want to understand the way Indian governments since independence have tried to develop a quota system or reservation system in order to improve the relative status of women and lower caste Indians, you really need to go through this long history. And again, this is another example of how inequality is historically constructed through specific historical and social processes, and you know, you don't have a permanent logic of any form. Part three of the book is about the big reduction of inequalities that you see in the 20th century, and in particular with the huge crises of ownership societies between 1914 and 1945, the rise of what I call social democratic societies after World War II, and the success, the huge success that they've had, but also the limitations that they faced starting in the 1980s. I talk about communist and post-communist societies, which in a way have become today the best ally of hyper-capitalism and some form of financial opacity today. You know, think of Russia, for instance. Part four of the book is about the transformation of the electoral coalition that have made the reduction of inequality possible in the 20th century. So in particular, I look at the rise of what I call the Brahmin left, the fact that the electorate, you know, voting for the Democratic Party in the US or the Social Democratic Party in Europe, or Labour Party in Britain, Socialist Party in France, used to be more a working class electorate in the 50s, 60s, 70s, and have gradually become the party of the most highly educated. And I'm trying to understand the reason behind this evolution and how this has contributed to feeling by the lower socioeconomic groups of sort of being abandoned in terms of political representation and redistributive platform. This has contributed at the end of the period, you know, in recent decades, to feed the rise of social nativism and nationalist parties. You know, we've seen that in my own country, in France. You've seen that in Austria pretty well. We've seen that with Trump in the US, Brexit in Britain. And I think this is really the lack of a political representation and of a political platform of in order to pursue the reduction of inequalities that has sort of left wide open, you know, the possibility for this movement to develop. So in the last chapter of the book, you know, I present some elements for a more egalitarian and internationalist strategy. I'm not saying that, you know, it's going to be simple. You know, I think the nationalist discourse and returning to the nation state and sort of protecting identity and white European identity or North American identity, you know, of course, is a very simple discourse, you know, much simpler than trying to make proposal about social federalism or participatory socialism. And so, you know, it has a lot of strengths, you know, this sort of simple-minded nationalist discourse. But on the other hand, you know, it's not going to solve the problem we have to solve. It's not going to solve the problem of rising inequality. It's not going to solve the climate crisis, which requires a lot of international cooperation. So, you know, I think in the end, we'll have to return to a more internationalist and more egalitarian solution if we want to solve this problem. And the general lesson of the book is that we cannot just wait for the big crisis that will change the system for us. Crises sometimes are necessary for historical change, but ideas are even more important, and talking about exactly the content of the kind of new economic system that we want is very important. And I think very often, you know, especially after the fall of communism, we've sort of stopped thinking about, you know, another economic system and the future economic systems that we'd like, and it's very important to start thinking again if we don't want to end up in this nationalist trap that we see today. So if you look on this website, you will find the complete set of figures and tables in the book. You will find these slides also, and you will have a lot more information about the book. So let me start. So in the rest of the presentation, I'm going to try to make these four points. You know, first point is going to be about what I call here the failure of the French Revolution, and I will be clearer about this in a minute, but what I mean by this is that, you know, there's a promise for more equality at the time of the French Revolution, and in the end, in the 19th century, both in France but more generally in European societies and in the US, you have in fact a sort of sacralization of private property leading to extreme level of concentration of wealth and economic power, and the colonial dimension of property accumulation is probably the most extreme example of this sacralization of property and this hypocrisy also of the French Revolution and the Atlantic Revolution in general of the late 18th century. Point number two will be about the reduction of inequality in the 20th century and the role played by social mobilization and also by the internal contradictions of capital accumulation in this reduction of inequality. Point three will be about the rise of inequality since the 1980s, 1990s. And again, I will stress the role of two political and ideological factors, Reaganism and the fall of communism. So I really want to stress that in general, this kind of political and ideological factors are really the driving force behind change in inequality regime and rather than purely economic and technological forces. And I will agree that I will argue that the disillusion coming from post-communism and also from the failure of Reaganism, which sort of made a promise to have more innovation, more growth, more shared prosperity, or at least that all of the population will benefit from the extra innovation coming from the Reaganian policy, did not quite materialize and contributes to explain the kind of nationalist drift that we see today, in particular in the US under Trump, but more generally in the world. And then part four will be about these elements for an alternative path and about what I describe as the slow rise of social federalism and participatory socialism, which I view as a process that is ongoing, has been going on since the 19th century or even since the 18th century. So there is a long-run process toward a reduction of inequality. I try to put this process into perspective and try to describe some possible future next steps. But, this is not, this is something that has already started and that is already going on, I think, in many ways. Okay, so let me start with the first point, the failure of the French Revolution. So as I said, the revolution proclaims the formal equality of rights, but in practice tends to sacralize the right of property as a new religion, partly because there's a fear of not knowing where to stop, if we start to redistribute wealth, or at least this is one of the official sort of ideological justification for not redistributing. Maybe it could be fair to redistribute, but where are we going to stop? And therefore, we should not start because we will end up in chaos. And in the end, there's a lot of hypocrisy in this discourse, and probably the most extreme illustration of this hypocrisy is the episode where you have this financial compensation to slave owners rather than to slaves at the time of the abolition, and more generally the colonial inequality dimension is very striking. So let me start with the first figure, which is the evolution of concentration of wealth in a country like France. I should say, the numbers for the share of wealth going to the top 1% and to the bottom 50% at the end of the period are very representative of European societies or society, a country like Austria, from what we know. In the US, it will be even more concentrated. So in the US, so here you see today, the bottom 50% share is about 6% of total wealth. So it was 2% in the 19th century, so 6% is better than 2%, but for 50% of the population, of course, this is pretty small. In the US, it will be more 3% of total wealth for the bottom 50%. The top 1% share in France today will be around 25%. It will be similar in Austria or Germany, 25, sometimes 30%. In the US, now it's up to 40%. But in any case, whatever the uncertainties about the specific number, 25, 30, 40%, and the differences between Western countries, you can see that the extreme concentration of wealth that we have today, in the sense that the bottom 50% group, in spite of the fact that they are 50 times more numerous than the top 1%, would have a share in total wealth that is, four or five times smaller than the top 1%. At the same time, there's been a reduction of inequality. So, both are true at the same time. You still have a lot of wealth inequality, but it was even worse before. So, sometimes people have a difficulty when they look at the history of inequality to understand these complexities, is that, you have at the same time a long-run reduction of inequality. But, it will be, I think it's difficult to say that this is the best we can do. Or, you have to explain, why is it that half of the population, the best we can do is that they don't own anything. That's part of the question I'm trying to raise in this book. So in the 19th century, it was, you know, up until World War I, it was up to 70% of the wealth for the top 1% in France or in Paris. In France, it was between 50 and 60%. Which was even more that at the beginning of the 19th century or at the eve of the French Revolution. So in that sense, you know, there was the promise toward more equality did not materialize. I mean, there was more equality in the sense there was formal equality of rights, which is not negligible, of course. But in terms of real effective social economic inequality, equality, you know, you didn't really have more access to property, and you need to wait until World War I, World War II, and the big political and social transformation of the 20th century to have some reduction of inequality. And this big fall of the top 1% share happened mostly to the benefit of the next 20, 30, 40%, you know, the people who are missing from this graph, of course, have the difference between the two groups. But for the bottom 50%, this made a little difference. So if we go back, so I will return later to the fall of inequality in the 20th century. If we start with the 19th century, so why is it that there's no reduction of inequality? Well, first, because, you know, there's no real attempt to redistribute wealth at the time of the French Revolution. You know, you nationalize some of the church land, but in fact, the objective is to reimburse some of the public debt to private property owners, and more generally, the government will auction the church land to people. So in order to buy the land, you already need to have some money, and so the people who don't have property, you know, landless peasants, most of the time they don't get anything. So there's no real attempt to do a land reform of the kind we see in a number of countries in the 20th century with explicit redistribution toward poor peasants. So there is, I'm going to skip this. There are actually some explicit proposal at the time of the French Revolution for progressive taxation of income and inheritance, but they will not be adopted. So you see, these are two examples, one on progressive tax on income, another on progressive tax on inheritance. So both, you know, they start at 5% tax rate for people with income below average income or inherited wealth below average inheritance, and then they go to 15, 50, 70% for very high wealth or income level. So this is actually very close to what will be adopted in the 20th century in the US or in a number of European countries. But you had explicit proposal like this you know, in the 18th century, at the time of the French Revolution. Condorcet also made some proposal like this. Thomas Paine made a proposal to use a progressive inheritance tax to pay for a capital endowment to everybody. But the balance of power at the time does not really allow for the adoption of this. Also, I discuss in the book that, you know, you can imagine some different trajectories of events during the revolution where it could have been adopted, but it's not adopted. One of the arguments for not adopting progressive taxation during the 19th century in France, but throughout Europe, more generally, is the idea that, you know, you will never know where to stop. And so in France during the 19th century, the system will be a completely flat tax system, 1% on inheritance, whether you transmit 1,000 francs or 100 million francs, and the argument, you know, so there are some political discussion in 1848, in 1871, but you always have this argument that, you know, if you start having 5% on the very high fortune, you know, then you will put 10, 50, 80, you will never know where to stop, therefore you should not try, which is, you know, a bit, you know, quite conservative, of course, and a bit hypocritical, but at the same time, it is true that in the 19th century, this has never been tried before. So, you know, after all, what would happen if you try? Now, the problem with this argument of not opening the sort of Pandora's box of wealth redistribution is that it also leads to very extreme policy, sort of quasi-sacralization of private property rights, which may be the most extreme illustration of that is what happens at the time of the abolition of slavery. So let me start with the example of Haiti, which I don't know how you are familiar with this example. So Haiti the name of Haiti was Saint-Domingue in the 18th century. This was the main slave island of the Atlantic Ocean. You know, this was French. This was a French colony. And this was the biggest concentration of slaves in the 18th century. So you had 500,000 slaves at the beginning of the French Revolution in Haiti. And you see there was a huge expansion of the slavery system all along the 18th century. More than 90% of the population was made of slaves at Haiti, and this was producing, in particular, sugar and bringing huge profits to French slave owners. Now, there was a slave revolt in Haiti in 1791, at the beginning of the French Revolution. You know, it's starting with a small fraction of the free mixed race population asking for political rights. You know, hearing about the French Revolution and saying, well, after all, maybe we could also have some political rights, and people saying, well, no, it's not possible because you don't have the right color. And so there was a slave revolt. They pushed the slave owners out. And then the French Assembly in 1794 decided to abolish slavery, but in fact they did not really have the choice because slave owners had been pushed out of the islands. And slavery was then re-established under Napoleon in 1802, and you need to wait until 1848 to see the end of slavery in the other French slave islands, Martinique, Guadeloupe, Réunion. But Haiti, they take their independence in 1804, and when finally the French monarchy, restored French monarchy in 1825, accepts the independence of Haiti, it's only at one condition, is that Haiti should reimburse to France, you know, the value of the slave property that French slave owners have lost. And so there's a big discussion about this value, but you know, the discussion is a bit one-sided because you have the French fleet that threatens to invade the island of Haiti. So in the end, Haiti accepts to repay what the amount at the time are set at the equivalent of 3 years of production of Haiti at the time, so we will say 300% of GDP, which of course cannot be reimbursed in 1 year. So the French bankers came, proposed to refinance the debt with interest rate, and in the end, Haiti repaid this debt to France until the 1950s. Okay, so during almost one century and a half. And you know, this story is still there with us in the sense that you know, in 1904, the French president of the Third Republic, you know, refused to go to the 100th anniversary of Haiti because the feeling at the time in France was that Haiti was not repaying fast enough their debt, and you know, the slave owners that had been expropriated, you know, were asking for quicker repayment or their families and descendants. And in 2004, you know, the French president Jacques Chirac, you know, also refused to go to the 200th anniversary of Haiti because French diplomats told him, well, you know, if you go, they will ask you to give back the money to Haiti, so you should not go. So, you know, I don't know what will happen for the 300th anniversary, but you know, it's just saying that this is a long story. Now, the same policy to compensate slave owners happened in every abolition of slavery. So it's not only France, you know, the British abolition of slavery in British slave islands in 1833 also involved full compensation of slave owners, and it was the same in 1848 for the abolition of slavery on the other French slave island. Lincoln in 1860 proposed to Southern slave owners in the US also financial compensation for the end of slavery. Financial, you know, slave owners in the south of the U.S. Did not accept this possibility, wanted a war to become independent, and then after the war, of course, they didn't get compensation for their loss of property given the war that they had caused. But and in 1888, which was, so if you look, you know, this is the evolution of the slavery system in the Atlantic Ocean. You know, the first abolition are in the French and British slave islands, with full compensation to slave owners. Then you have the end of the US slavery system after the Civil War, 1860 and 1865. And in the last big abolition, which was in Brazil and Cuba in 1888, you have, again, financial compensation to slave owners. And so at the time, you know, liberal, so-called liberal intellectuals like Tocqueville in France would always say, you know, you need full compensation to slave owners, not to slaves. You know, well, there were some people like Condorcet at the time of the French Revolution defended the idea of a compensation to slaves, paying a pension to old slaves, giving a piece of land to young slaves so that they can work for themselves. But this was not the majority opinion. You know, like, again, liberal intellectuals like Tocqueville, you know, always said, well, no, if you start, you know, if you, the argument was pretty strong. The idea is if you expropriate a slave owner with no compensation, you know, where are you going to stop? You know, what are you going to do, for instance, with someone who owned slaves in the past, who sold his slaves 10 years ago, and who now has a castle near Bordeaux or a building in Paris? You're going to ask him something. And therefore, you know, step by step, you're going to re-question the entire property system. And indeed, you know, probably, you know, we should have asked, you know, some kind of progressive taxation of large wealth owners, everybody who had benefited from slavery. But as you can see from this example, you know, the fear of opening this Pandora box of property rights established in the past, you know, can lead in practice to pretty extreme solution. So more generally, you know, the extreme level that you observe, you know, in the context of slavery, but also post-slavery colonial society is very striking. So we have started to collect a lot of data on French colonies and British colonies. Countries like Algeria, you know, have a level of inequality of income in 1930 or until the independence of Algeria, which is much larger than any level of inequality we have today in Brazil or Middle East. This is due to extreme concentration of property, but also, of course, to a lot of explicit discrimination in the legal system, in the educational system. So here you have, you know, the concentration. So this is the concentration of income in France 1910, Algeria 1930, Haiti 1780. So Haiti is the most extreme case. You know, the bottom 90% of the population is made of slaves. Algeria is a bit less extreme, but still very extreme. France 1910 is a very unequal country, but as you see, inequality in colonies, post-slavery colonies, and slave colonies is even larger. In post-slavery colonies, the huge inequality also comes from all the discrimination in the social educational system. So this is the concentration of educational investment comparing Algeria at the before independence, France at the beginning of the 20th century, and France today. So you can see, basically, in Algeria, in colonial Algeria, you know, 80% of total educational spending will go to 10% of the population, which are basically the European colonial settlers, well, French and a little bit Italian. So you know, there's just no educational spending for the rest of the population. This doesn't mean that it's very equal within France. You know, it's actually very unequal, you know, given the share. Even today, I will come back to this later, you know, the top 10% is receiving much more educational investment per student than the bottom 50%. You know, their share is twice as small as the bottom 50%, but they are five times less numerous, so they, per student, they receive a lot more educational investment. But as compared to the inequality in educational opportunities in colonial societies, you know, this has nothing to do. So inequality comes from somewhere. You know, property, education, you know, are two of the main determinants of the origins of inequality. And from that viewpoint, you know, you see in the 19th century and in the first half of the 20th century in colonial societies, sort of very extreme level of inequality. Now, if we move, so I'm going to skip some part to accelerate a little bit. If we move now to the reduction of inequality in the 20th century, well, this is going to take place through, you know, so of course, large crises, including World War I, the Great Depression, World War II, the Bolshevik Revolution, are going to accelerate the process towards the reduction of inequality. But I want to stress that you have also a very strong intellectual, political movement starting in the 19th century, which was sort of preparing the ground for this big transformation. And we had, you know, there was the preparation of a policy platform in terms of social security, labor rights, labor law, progressive taxation, which you know, was being prepared and then could be applied after, you know, in times of crisis, and which is a little bit what I think missing today is that, you know, we see the possible crisis, but we don't always see the sort of the positive platform to be applied coming out of this. So what are the policy platforms that were sort of being prepared and that were applied after the crisis, the rise of the social state and the welfare state in general. So you can see that before World War One, so this is how tax revenues were used. So this is the average for four European countries, which are Germany, France, Britain, and Sweden, but it will be relatively close. There are differences between European countries, but it's a relatively representative pattern. Before World War One, most of the tax revenue will pay to keep order and to pay for the military that will be used for the military expansion. Educational spending was increasing a little bit, but was always less than 1% of national income until World War One, or even less than 0.5% of national income in Europe. In the US, which had historically an educational advance over Europe, it was like 1% of national income, which is still twice as much, but pretty small. Over the course of the 20th century, it has increased to 6% of national income, so it has been multiplied by 10, and this has been one of the key drivers toward more equality, through universal access to primary and secondary education, and also toward more prosperity. You note that at the end of the period, there's actually a stagnation in educational investment, partly because we've starting in the 1980s, 90s, we've entered a new regime where the dominant view has been that we should stabilize the level of total tax revenue, that we know we cannot continue increasing towards 60-70%. Maybe we could still have increased a little bit more, but anyway, the choices that have been made has been a complete stabilization, which given that you have an increased spending on health and pension with the aging of population, even with increasing debt, which at some point we'll have to address, education, you cannot increase everything. So you have this stagnation or even this small decline in educational investment, which is sort of very paradoxical because the proportion of a generation going to higher education has increased a lot, of course, since the 80s. So it means that the public investment per children has actually been reduced in on average in most European countries and also in the US, which I think is probably one of the key reasons for the slowdown of economic growth in the past 30 years. But anyway, over the course of the 20th century, there's been a big increase in public investment in education, health, pension, and this has played a major role for the reduction of inequality and also for the increase in productivity and prosperity. So this is for the average rate of taxation. Now, the other important revolution has been the introduction of progressive taxation. So this is the evolution of the top income tax rate in the five largest industrial economies of the 20th century. So you can see that before World War One, there was very limited income tax. So France, in purple, was the very last country to introduce income tax. That was in the summer of 1914, and this was not to pay for investment in schools. This was to pay for the war with Germany. This was the law of July 15, 1914, and it was adopted by the French Parliament to pay for the war. And before that, the French Parliament didn't want an income tax. And the big argument in France at the time was, we have made the French Revolution, so we are already a country of equals, and so we don't need progressive taxation. Whereas, in my data, in fact, the concentration of wealth at the time was just as extreme as in other European countries. But this shows, the power of ideology. And in that example, sometimes the tendency to use sort of national narrative in order to provide some storytelling that can justify, actually maintaining the position of the elite. Well, anyway, after World War One and after the Great Depression and World War II, you have a huge rise of the level of tax progressivity. So in particular, the US is the first country to invent very high rate of taxation on very top incomes. On average, between 1930 and 1980, it's over 80%. Apparently, this did not destroy US capitalism, otherwise we would have noticed it. And in fact, I think, if you look at this experience today, I think this contributed to the reduction of inequality with, in fact, very high growth rate and partly because this helped finance investment in public infrastructure, education, and also this helped convince the rest of society that you know it was fair to pay more tax to pay for public spending, public infrastructure, because at least you know that the people at the top are paying more than you do, which today is not the case and can be a big problem in our basic social contract. So in the 1980s, following Reagan and Thatcher, you've been a big decline of top income tax rate, particularly in US and Britain, and I will come back to this later. But you know, I think this experience, in particular of the US, you know, to me, between 1930 and 1980, if you look at it again today, you know, bringing a lot of historical data, you know, I think was by and large successful. So it's very difficult to have a quiet discussion about this, because when you talk about this kind of tax rate, you know, 80-90% of very high incomes, you know, many people stop listening and, you know, they think, you know, you are a Bolshevik or you know, that you're talking about the Soviet Union. And so you tell them, well, no, this is the United States, Japan, Britain. But, you know, some people just stop listening and it's very difficult to have just the beginning of a quiet conversation. You know, I think people should accept at least to look at the historical evidence and to have an informed discussion. So I know, you know, people like Trump, you know, you tell them about the history of this, you know, they don't listen, but, you know, we don't need to go down to the level of Trump. And I think, you know, even conservative people, you know, should accept to look at this history again, because if we refuse completely to learn from history and to discuss about this historical experience, which, of course, are not perfect and do not never provide, you know, complete certainty about what we should do, but still provide some insight. And if we refuse that and if we refuse to learn from history, then we are left with very little, you know, in terms of rational basis for a political conversation. So this is what you have for the income tax. You have, if you look at effective tax rate in the US, you know, you can see that tax, so these are the effective tax rate combining all forms of tax, both income tax, indirect tax, social security contribution. And so you can see that between 1920 and 1980, there was real effective progressivity in the US. So it was not just statutory tax rate, you know, it was effective also tax rates that were hugely progressive, and this has disappeared at the end of the period. So you also have rise of progressive taxation for inheritance tax, which is also very striking, in particular in the US, UK, very large top inheritance tax rate. Now, what made all this change possible? So this is a complete transformation of attitudes toward inequality, and in particular high wealth and high income as compared to the 19th century regime of property sacralization. Of course, what made this possible is what at least accelerated this change is this major political shock that happened between 1914 and 1945. In particular, World War I, which sort of puts, you know, creates, you know, puts all these countries in a completely different trajectory. But what I want to stress is that the war itself, you know, can also be viewed and probably should be viewed as a consequence of extreme inequality within European countries, which created a lot of social tension, and even most importantly, between countries. And probably that's the most important contradiction. So here on this graph, you have the level of foreign assets, you know, foreign property. So in particular, if you look at Britain and France, that were the two leading colonial powers, you know, they own in the rest of the world, well, you know, British and French property owners, because of course most people did not own anything, but those who had property own in the rest of the world, you know, a vast quantity of wealth. So some of this wealth was pure war tribute, you know, like the Haiti debt, you know, that's part of these foreign assets, and colonial powers at the time were imposing war tributes pretty much everywhere, you know, to Morocco, to China, to pretty much everybody. Some of it was corresponds more to investment, like the Suez Canal or you know, railways in Latin America or in Russia or in Indochina. But what's important to have in mind is that the level of accumulation, so you know, at the eve of World War I. So this is going to change completely following World War I. But at the eve of World War I, Britain owns almost 200% of national income in foreign assets, France over 100%. Now, this is bringing so much capital income from the rest of the world that these two countries, so Britain has an extra 10% of national income through interest, profits, dividend. France has an extra 5% of national income. So these two countries can actually afford, they are in permanent trade deficit. They have 2-3% of GDP trade deficit between 1880 and 1914. But this is not a problem for them because the money they get in profit income from abroad is much bigger. So this allows them not only to buy the, to finance the trade deficit, but to keep buying the rest of the world. So, you know, it's as if, you know, you pay rent to your landlord, and with the rent, the landlord buys the rest of the building around you. And so this is a process that can go very far. And which, what I want to argue, you know, from this graph is that this, you know, this could not continue forever, you know. So in the end, World War I put an end to this process. But in any case, you know, it's very difficult to see how this speed of accumulation, you know, at some point, well, first the countries that were being owned, in particular in the colonial world, you know, will revolt and will get independence and will nationalize some of these assets. And this is, in the end, what happened. But the shock that really started, you know, the beginning of the end was indeed World War I, which itself was largely due to the fact that, you know, you had this competition between European state powers. And in particular, you can see Germany was much below France and Britain in terms of foreign asset accumulation. But at the same time, Germany had become the leading demographic power and manufacturing power of Europe at the end of the 19th century and at the beginning of the 20th century. So here you sort of had a contradiction between the distribution of political and in particular international political power and international foreign assets and the distribution of internal European economic strengths. And so this contradiction, you know, of course, contributed a lot, we know today, to what happened with World War I, World War II, and, you know, there was such a, you know, this kind of extreme competition between countries led to a very unstable system. You know, this is something that Karl Polanyi, you know, has studied a lot in his 1944 book on the Great Transformation. And I think if you go back through this series, it's indeed very striking. If you compare, you know, today, you have some countries like China, Japan, Germany that are accumulating trade surpluses in the rest of the world and that are accumulating foreign reserve in the rest of the world, but, you know, this is still much smaller than what we had at this time. So this is going to disappear following World War I because of a big crash in stock prices and also a beginning of expropriation, like Russian bonds were expropriated. But most importantly, the fall is due to the fact that the war itself has to be financed and that these property owners, you know, they will have to sell some of their foreign assets in order to buy some public bonds by this government in order to pay for the war. And if you look at the situation 30 years later, you know, in 1945, 1950, you don't have foreign assets left, but you have enormous public debt. So here you have the public debt of France, Germany, Britain, and you can see in 1945, 1950, you have 200%, 300% of public debt. So it's to a large part the translation of these foreign assets that have been sold and that have been lent to governments in order to pay for the war. Now, what's interesting is that France and even more so Germany are going to decide around 1950 not to repay this public debt. So France, you have a lot of inflation to get rid of the debt. But in Germany, there was already a lot of inflation in the 1920s, as you can see, the green curve, which allowed Germany to get rid of its World War I public debt. But at the same time, it had all sorts of other negative consequences, as we all know. And between 1948 and 1952, Germany uses a much more sophisticated and I think much more successful policy to get rid of its public debt, which is a big exceptional wealth tax, you know, going from less than 5% on small wealth owners to up to 80-90% on very large wealth portfolio, both real estate, financial wealth. And, you know, it's very strange when you today when we have a discussion about wealth taxation, we say, oh, it's impossible to tax financial wealth, etc. But somehow in 1950, you know, there was no computer and no digital technology, but we found a way, you know, I don't know why, but so, and in the end, this was very successful. So this wealth portfolio at the top were made mostly of public bonds. So in effect, you tax at 90% the public debt in order to reduce the public debt. So it's a bit trivial as a strategy, but you know, the public debt belongs to someone. It does not belong to the Mars planet, so you have to do something, and at least this solution that was applied in Germany, which was also applied in Japan, by the way, so it's not like a German invention, you know, it's also in times of crisis, you need to find solutions, and you don't have so many different solutions. This was very successful because, in effect, you know, you can preserve the bottom group, which with inflation are not very well preserved and in fact can be hit much harder than the higher wealth group, and you ask more effort to the higher wealth group. So this was very successful in the sense that this allowed Germany and Japan to get rid of their public debt very fast. So in the 1955, they had less than 20% of national income in public debt, which gave them more financial means to invest in public infrastructure, in education, and the success of the reconstruction period owes to that. And you know, if we had made the choice to repay this public debt with no inflation, no exceptional wealth tax, and just repaying through budget surplus of 1-3% of GDP each year, we will still be repaying it today. And so in effect, we will be sending some of our tax revenue to the children of people, you know, who had a public debt portfolio at the time. We were themselves children of people who had a foreign asset portfolio in 1914, and you know, this would have been really stupid. But it's important to see that, you know, the reduction of inequality in the 20th century came through a complete intellectual transformation of the way we look at private property, and the view that sometimes, you know, you have to question some of the property rights set in the past. I'm not saying this is simple to do, but you know, it's a bit ironical that today, you know, Germany and France, you know, are explaining Southern Europe that you're going to have to repay, you know, each euro of public debt with no inflation, with no cancellation, with you know, just by having slow, you know, budget surplus for the next 50 years, which of course is not at all the way we've rebuilt Europe in the 1950s. So I think this kind of historical amnesia is a bit problematic, and I think going back through history is important because it shows that, you know, this opens up, you know, this can open up the discussion for more alternative solutions, which are always complicated, but you know, I think it's important to see that you know, there are different options in history that can be chosen. Now let me accelerate and come to the more recent period and the rise of inequality since the 1980s, 90s. And I'm going to stress two factors. One is post-communism and the fact that the failure of Soviet communism and also the failure of Chinese Maoist communism, you know, have contributed to the you know, general feeling of disillusion about you know, changing the economic system, and in a way, post-communist societies have become the best ally of hyper-capitalism. And the other big change is the rise of Reaganism, and finally, the failure of Reaganism, which I will argue, you know, also contributes to a new form of nationalism and identitarian drift that we have. That we have today. So if we start with communism, from the data we have, you know, we which is very imperfect for Russia, but it looks as if income inequality in Russia after the fall of communism has increased very fast, you know, following in particular the very fast privatization of Russia to the benefit of a small group of people that have become known as the oligarchs, and that we see sometimes, you know, in London, Paris, or Vienna, even I hear, and who have accumulated a lot of wealth. Before, you know, at the end of communism, the level of monetary inequality in Soviet Russia was relatively small, although not very different from Western Europe, and in fact it was even probably a bit more than in Sweden. So the problem was not so much the extreme level of monetary inequality, but rather the organization of the economy and the very centralized state property structure, as opposed to the more the mixed economy and with more workers' rights and more decentralization that you could have in some Western European countries. If you take the case of Russia today, you know, what's very striking also is the huge opacity in wealth ownership. You know, so these are estimates about the share of financial assets held in tax haven done by my friend and colleague Gabriel Zucman, and from the data he has, which is certainly incomplete, Russia is at the top of the world with Gulf countries and petro-monarchies of the Gulf in terms of using financial tax havens in order to own Russia. And it's a bit ironical that the countries that wanted to abolish completely private property ends up to be the world leader in tax haven today. It's also a country, Putin's Russia is a country where you don't have any attempt to redistribute anything. The income tax is completely flat, so it's 13%. Whether you have 100 rubles per month or 100 billion rubles per month is 13%. So even Trump does not dare proposing that, and maybe we'll do it one day, but this is not right now what's sort of allowed in the US political discourse. You have no inheritance tax, so it's a 0% inheritance tax in Russia today, like in China. Where you privatize a big part of what can be owned, and then you can transmit everything to your children at 0%. And so today, you have the incredible situation in Asia where, in effect, it's only if you want to transmit a fortune in Asia, you should go and die in People's Republic of China. If you go to Taiwan or if you go to South Korea or to Japan, you will pay an inheritance tax of 40 or 50%, and in Japan it was even increased to 55% 3 years ago by a center-right government, and there's not a particularly left-wing culture in Japan, but in China it's 0%. In Hong Kong it has been set to 0%, and actually inequality has increased a lot in Hong Kong after they became communist, or after they joined communist China and became under the control of the Chinese Communist Party. So this illustrates this kind of big ideological shift, which of course go very far and sometimes too far. The other big ideological change starting in the 1980s is the rise of Reaganism, which here the ideological discourse was very much something like this. The idea was we are going to cut tax on entrepreneurs. Maybe this is going to increase inequality. The top 1% share will increase. There will be more billionaires, more entrepreneurs. But this will bring so much more innovation and so much more growth that in the end, even if the bottom 50% share is reduced, it will be a share of a bigger pie, and therefore, income and wage in America are going to grow like what you've never seen. Except that, in fact, what we've seen 30 years later is that the growth rate of national income per capita in the US has actually been divided by two. So if you look 1990 to 2020, national income per capita in the US has increased at 1.1% per year, as opposed to 2.2% per year between 1950 and 1990. So it's very difficult, I think, today to pretend that the trickle-down approach of Reagan worked. It was plausible at the time, or at least some people believed that it could be true and supported this. But if you want to defend this today, you will need to explain why. Maybe you will need to explain that the growth rate in the U.S. was about to be divided by four. And that thanks to the Reagan policy, it was only divided by two. It's possible, but it's complicated. And you need to find some good reason why it was about to be divided by four. Now, this led to a sort of big disillusion today. And I think this contributes to explain the rise of Trumpism today, which is now trying to find some new explanation for the fact that the middle class in the US or the lower socioeconomic groups did not really benefit from a lot of growth. And Trump is sort of proposing a story based on the idea that it's because of the Mexican workers, it's because of China, it's because of the rest of the world. And I think this sort of nationalist response is to some extent the consequence of the failure of Reaganism. Now, at the same time, the left and social democratic parties, were not really able to develop, to resist to the deregulation that happened in the 80s, 90s, and sometimes, in fact, contributed to the process. In addition, if you look in the longer run, what's very striking, and this is where I would like to end this presentation, and I'm trying to look at someone who tells me, how much time I have left, because otherwise, you know, I will speak forever, which will be 5 to 10 minutes. Okay, that's good. That's exactly what I need. Yes. So on this graph, this is a description of the transformation of the electoral structure of, you know, who votes for the Social Democrats since the war. So if you take the blue curve, this is for the Democratic Party in the US. So on this graph, you have the difference between how many people will vote for, say, the Democratic Party in blue among the most highly educated group, and how many vote for them among the less educated group. So when it's negative at the end of the period, it means that these parties were getting stronger support among the less educated group of society. And at the time, you know, they were able, through a platform of redistribution, educational expansion, investment in primary, secondary education for all, more workers' rights, social security, redistributive taxation, to sort of, they were able to attract, you know, the vote and form a coalition of voters with lower education, lower income, lower wealth. Now, over time, you can see that these parties have actually become, the reverse has happened. These parties have become the party of the most highly educated. Now, it is not true for wealth. You know, you still have the fact that the voters with higher wealth tend to vote more for right parties or center-right parties. So this is the rise of what I describe in my book as a sort of multiple elite system. You have a sort of Brahmin left, highly educated left voting for social democrats, and merchant right, you know, sort of business elite, you know, sometimes anti-intellectual elite, you know, of Trump will be the extreme illustration, voting for the right. Now, the problem is that if you are in neither of the elite, you know, you can feel completely abandoned in such a political system. And indeed, you know, I think one of the problems that these parties have faced over time is that they have been viewed more and more as the parties of the winner of the education system, and you know, people that were less successful, partly because they had lower social economic origin or because they were less successful for other reasons, might, you know, have felt gradually being sort of looked down at them. And I think this has contributed to some of the big transformations that we've seen in recent decades. So you see that in US, France, Britain, but you also see that in Norway, Sweden, Germany. So we've started to look at many other countries. Yes, you don't have Austria there, but I guess, you know, we could do the same with Austria. Now, another political evolution which I want to describe is more generally, you know, political attitudes toward globalization and in particular European integration, because, you know, of course the European Union is like a little laboratory of globalization. And what we see is this huge social division over Europe and over globalization in general. So here, this is, you know, the vote over Brexit in 2016. So this is the percentage voting, percentage of the population voting to remain in the European Union, depending on your decile of income, education, and wealth. And so you can see that, you know, it's basically, it's only the top 30% who support the European Union. So the top 10% voted to remain in the European Union with a lot of enthusiasm, but you know, the bottom 60% say no, and in the end, the you know, Brexit won with 52%. Now, when you see, I don't know in Austria, but when you see this kind of graph in France, you know, people, some people will tell you, well, okay, this is because of this crazy British nationalist. There's nothing we can do about it, and actually, we're going to be very good without them. And but I think this is wrong. I think, well, first, you know, there's no reason why the lower socioeconomic group should be more nationalist than the rich. You know, for a long time, the working class was very internationalist. So, you know, it depends what kind of political project you have around nationalism or internationalism. There's no natural reason why, you know, this group should be more nationalist. Most importantly, you know, you see that not only in Britain, but in fact, you have exactly the same pattern. If you look in France, you know, so these are the referendum of 1992 and 2005 about Europe in France. And again, you have only the top groups, you know, that support Europe. So I should say, you know, I voted yes in these two referendum, and I am very much, you know, European federalist. But at the same time, I think it's important to take this seriously. And you know, when you have two very different countries, you know, France and Britain, at, you know, 1992, 2005, 2016, and you always have this same very strong social division over European integration and over globalization in general, and you would have the same about globalization in the US. You cannot say, okay, this is a simple misunderstanding, we are going to explain better next time, and this is going to go away. You know, I think we have to take seriously the idea that you cannot have a free exchange and free flows of goods, services, capital without any common public regulation, any explicit social objective about the reduction of inequality, about wage policy, education, progressive taxation, educational justice, because otherwise, you know, the groups with the lowest level of human capital, financial capital, you know, feel that they, you know, it's only the top groups that are gaining from the integration, and in the end, you know, you have this sort of basic contradiction of the system that can make it explode. You have this contradiction in relation to inequality within country. You also have contradiction in terms of between countries inequality. And here I want to illustrate the case of Western versus Eastern Europe, which I thought in Austria is particularly important and visible. So as you know, Poland, Hungary, Czech Republic, you know, Eastern European countries, they are receiving public transfer from European Union budget, you know, between 2 and 3%, 4% of GDP. So this is the green curve. The problem is that, you know, when you look at this situation from the point of view of Germany or France, you know, you only look at this public transfer and you completely forget, you know, the private profits that are being made by German firms or sometimes maybe Austrian firms or French firms in Eastern European countries, which are extremely large and which are due to partly to very low level of wages in Eastern Europe, or to the fact that wages in Eastern Europe did not increase as much as some people expected. And this is what allowed these German investors or French investors to make big profits in this country. And this is something that's very visible for people in Eastern Europe. You know, they see their wage level and they see the wage on the other side of the frontier in Germany or in Austria, and they can see the difference. And so the Western European attitude, which will be, you know, it will be something like, well, okay, you know, wages and profits, you know, there's nothing we can do about this. You know, this is the law of the market. This is a pure and imperfect competition that determines the level of wages and profits. And all what matters is the public transfer that we give you after the market has operated. And this is evidence of our generosity, and you should not complain, and why do you complain? And well, except that, as we know, you know, wages and profits are not, you know, do not come from the sky. They depend on the legal system, the bargaining system, the existence of social harmonization or workers' rights, union rights, bargaining power. And I think if we refuse this discussion, and if we want to organize the European Union, or more generally, globalization, simply on the basis of market competition, market discipline, without talking about all this regulation and the sort of the way markets are socially structured and embedded through legal rules and social rules, then we run into a major misunderstanding which threatens to put the entire process of European integration and more generally of globalization under threat. You could make the same remark about misunderstanding between Northern Europe and Southern Europe about interest rate around the Eurozone public debt. You know, French and German public authorities, you know, tend to explain to Greece, okay, you know, you were about to get 10% interest rate on the market, and we have been lending to you at 4 or 5% money that we borrowed at 0 or 1%, so we've been very generous with you. And of course, you know, again, that there's a major misunderstanding, because on the Greek side, they will say, well, look, you made a huge financial margin on us. So, and both statements are true. You know, it, again, it depends what you take as a referential. You know, is the referential the market price, and in this case, the market interest rate, or do you accept, you know, the idea that in this case, you know, the market interest rate is very highly speculative, and in fact, you know, it would be better to have a common public debt and a common interest rate and no speculation in this market. And you know, in the US, if the Federal Reserve Bank had to choose every morning between the interest rate of California, Louisiana, Alabama, you know, it would be a huge mess, just like in Europe. And in the end, the economic stagnation and very low interest rate for German savers or Dutch savers, etc. You know, it's not work. This whole system is not really working for anyone. So let me conclude and stop there and summarize. You know, some of the conclusion for the future. You know, so some of them I have already referred to them, and some others. You know, I can answer questions about them. I think, you know, if we try to think of a different way of organizing the economy, we have to build on you know, what has been successful in the 20th century. So I think, you know, the social state and in particular education is the prime force to reduce inequality. The problem is that we need more educational justice, in particular in higher education. And I think the huge hypocrisy in access to higher education that we have today, you know, is one of the reasons why there's been this complete transformation of the electorate voting for the social democratic parties, and why they have appeared more and more as the winners of the, you know, the party of the winners of the education game. I have mentioned social federalism, which, you know, is the idea that you need to make free trade and free capital flows conditional upon binding objectives regarding economic justice, fiscal, social, and environmental justice. And social and temporary property, what I mean by this is to extend workers' rights, which, you know, has been largely a big success in the 20th century, in particular in you know, Germany, Austria, but also Sweden are examples where the co-determination system, you know, has allowed to better involve workers in the long-term decision of companies. And I think this can be extended to other countries. The system in itself can also be made more ambitious. And the better circulation of property. So in the book, I make proposal about inheritance for all. If we want to have a more equal distribution of bargaining power in societies, I think is also very important. So thanks a lot for your attention, and I'd be very happy to answer questions. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much, Thomas Piketty. Thank you very much. I will now get into the picture of the live stream. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you very much for attending this way and listening to Thomas Piketty. We will now finish the live stream. Have a very nice Friday afternoon and stay healthy, please. So, we'll have a seat now, I think, and I think this is going to be taken.